Returning to a series I started 20 episodes ago, it's MediEvil 2. This time I had the sense to not try and cover the entire game in one video. Unlike the first game, I never got to play a demo before trying the real thing. A PS1 game I got, maybe for a birthday or maybe just a random gift, I can't remember, came with a demo disc that had a trailer for this game, but that was all before my grandmother bought this one after enjoying the first. Unlike most of her other PS1 games from that time, it didn't survive into the present day. This copy I got secondhand for almost nothing back in 2012 or 2013, 6 or 7 years before I even got the first game again, but I only played about halfway through for a day and didn't touch it again until for this video. This game is generally seen as a step down from the original, but how big a step depends on the person, so we'll see what I think by the end of the two videos this game will take to cover. We start with a quick recap of the final battle from the first game, seeing Sir Daniel Fortescue kill Zarok and return to his crypt to die again, but we don't see him in the Hall of Heroes, so who knows if the good ending is canon. After that, time passes and Gallowmere no longer exists. It's now 500 years later and in London. Dan's remains are now an exhibit in a museum next to a dinosaur skeleton. But outside there are these three dodgy guys. The leader has a spell book and uses it to transform himself into a powerful sorcerer, animating statues, giving himself a terrible sunburn, and once again reanimating the dead. That includes the museum exhibits. On starting a new game, we begin with the first level, the museum. Of course, with the spell reaching the museum, this includes Dan as well. A ghost appears in front of him. This is Winston Chapelmount, the ghost of a child who died at 12 years old. He doesn't get to be revived like the others. He tells Dan to find a weapon and points out that if I see his trail, I can talk to him for hints. So he replaces the gargoyle heads. Like in the first game, without a weapon you can have Dan take his arm off and beat people with it or throw it like a boomerang, but it's not very damaging. But I don't need to bother with it, as across the corridor from Dan's exhibit is a statue in a glass case I can break open and regain the small sword from. Back in the corridor are these green hands wandering around. We'll deal with those later. Down the end of the corridor, the next room has the return of the basic zombie enemies. As I kill one and grab the museum key, you can see that the Chalice of Souls return, as it fills up by 3% in the corner of the screen. Killing the rest brings the chalice up to 11% before I go through the door into the next room. Skeletons in armour are animated and break out of their casings. They swing their big swords but are kind of slow, and killing the two of them brings the chalice up to 27%. I go up the stairs and break into the case my first long range weapon, a pistol. Many weapons from the first game don't return and are replaced with weapons more fitting to the period, so say goodbye to the likes of the longbow and the throwing daggers. One gameplay improvement is that you can now have two weapons equipped at once and switch between them by pressing L1 and square, a good way to cut down on constantly entering the weapon menu. Going through the door here takes me back to the previous room, but at a higher level. To the left is a chest that lets me get back the copper shield. It works the same, and this time I start with the daring dash instead of having to unlock it. Further left is the door the museum key is for, but first I move left some more to grab some money, then I go through the door. Winston tells me about climbing, and I climb down to see the dinosaur skeleton smash a hole in the wall, letting in some little pterodactyl skeletons. These don't try to fight me, but I still gun them down anyway to bring the chalice to 39%. The dinosaur roars loud enough to knock over a statue, so I climb it to a higher level. I grab the money and go through the door to meet knights with huge cannons. They can either shoot them or try to smash my head in with them. They do quite a bit of damage, so fighting from a distance is probably the best choice. Chalice is at 47% before I go through the next door. Winston introduces me to the Spiv. Replacing the merchant gargoyles from the first game, he's the guy I can pay to refill my ammo. Nearby are 3 more pterodactyls to kill, getting me to 59%. Down the stairs is a very bouncy cannon, and 2 doors to the left and right. I go left first into the garden. The chalice is hanging out here, but obviously I can't grab it yet. After killing the 2 zombies here, more rise up from the ground and I kill them too. 75%. In the back there's a chest containing a cannonball before I take out 1 last zombie and go back. I put the cannonball in the cannon and then take the right door. I grab the torch in here and take out the 3 enemies to completely fill the chalice. I run back and grab it, then use a torch to light the cannon and blow open the path forward. Going into the next room, I go right to climb a ladder and run around the top of the room to grab some more money and the dinosaur key. This room has a few more exhibits to look at, including Zarek's head mounted on the wall. I use the key and go through the newly unlocked door. The dinosaur smashes through the wall again and lets in more pterodactyls. They actually end up posing a threat this time when they surround me and keep cutting off all my attacks with their own. After they're dead, the door opens. But first I jump through the hole in the wall to collect the bits of money laying around on the floor here. Then I go through the door. That was a good start to the game, but I just feel a museum lacks the atmosphere of the graveyard if we're comparing first levels. This level has a part 2 dedicated to a boss, Tyrannosaurus Rex. Winston shows up to give me the chance to save and I definitely take it. We're still in the era of being able to save, but chances to save weren't always very forgiving. He also says that after I deal with the dinosaur, he'll take Dan to meet his boss. I go up the stairs and through the door. Wreckage collapses in front of it to keep me from escaping, and the dinosaur falls in front of me. First thing I do is run into another nearby door and up the stairs. I stock up on some pistol ammo from the spiv and leap through the nearest door to end up on the upper level of the boss arena. I find a spot to heal, but the boss breathes fire on me in the middle of it. Dick. It'll also ram into the walls to make debris fall near me. After a while, its brain appears and starts glowing, calling in more dinosaur skeletons. I just ignore them and run up its tail to strike the brain and take away half of its health. I then just wait for it to do that again and strike the brain once more to take the rest of its health. It breaks apart and then rebuilds itself in a flying form. I head back to the upper levels to take it on. It will fly from hole to hole in the ceiling, breathing fire at me. After a few cycles, it tries the brain thing again, giving me the chance to shoot it. Each shot takes 25 of its 400 HP, and I manage to take half of its health again before it repeats the pattern. I just blow its brains out some more to finally take it down. It leaves behind my first health expanding life bottle and opens up the exit so I can leave. I next show up at the professor's lab. I walk up to this professor's desk to get introduced. He's Professor Hamilton Kift, also a magician, inventor, and calls himself a master of the occult. The reason Dan is up and moving again is that someone has managed to obtain Zarok's spellbook. Then we get my least favourite change from the original to this. Yeah, instead of Dan's words being impossible to understand without subtitles due to lacking a jaw, here it just sounds like a dude sticking his fingers in a mouth and pulling his cheeks apart while he speaks. Not a fan. So people have been looking for the book for hundreds of years, with a few pages only turning up the previous year. Kift wants Dan to find the extent of the damage, as he is imprisoned in this sewer with no power. From the desk next to him, I hand over my chalice for a new weapon. This time he gets a new weapon to the series, the cane stick. This might actually be my least favourite melee weapon in the series, although I haven't played Resurrection yet. Just completely unremarkable. To select a stage, I have to stand in front of the film projector. The next stage is Kensington, where the blast from the spell originated from. I have to look around, collect magic, and work out who's behind it. I walk forward to find some corpses in the roads. As I approach them, some ghost dude with the staff shows up and zaps into life. I get killing them, but they don't add to the chalice. Only when all four are dead can I hit the necromancer. Killing him adds 18% to the chalice. Keeping to the left as I go down the road, I climb a ladder onto some train tracks. Running down it, I pass a bell and the spiv, more on that later. At the end, I drop down and climb another to reach the roof of the museum, where Winston tells me there's no going back. So I don't go that way yet. I drop down to the front of the museum and deal with another necromancer to bring the chalice to 36%. To the left is a locked door requiring the depot key. To the right of the museum, I go through a tunnel into a new area. Right away, I kill a third necromancer for 55% of a chalice filled. Around the corner, I hit a switch to lower a platform and then ride it back up to enter this building. I drop down and pull this crate to let me climb up to another section. I also grab the money hidden in the corner. Climbing the crate gets me the depot key. As I leave, some normal zombies rise up, letting me get the chalice to 63%. I take the other path in here through another tunnel back to the main area opposite the start point. Three more zombies get me up to 71%. This time I take the right path from the start to find a locked door needing the townhouse key. I return to the door to the depot where three more zombies rise to get that chalice to 78%. I then unlock the door and keep going. To the left, more zombies rise and the smart bomb in school chest return, taking them all out. 86%. I climb up the nearby ladder and go inside the building to find the townhouse key, freeing these Anubis from their coffins. These can be pains. They lunge at you up close, fire laser beams from a distance and will just sometimes become intangible so I can't hit them. But while taking them out, I manage to fill up the chalice. I pull a nearby crate to allow myself to leave. At this point I just ignore all enemies as I run to the townhouse to unlock it. Winston tells me that this is the house where the spell was cast and tells me to look around for clues and then go back to the museum. I go upstairs where behind a pile of boxes I find a pocket watch in a chest. This is my clue and now I can leave, but first the chalice. Remember that bell by the train tracks? I strike it to make it ring and call the train, which is carrying the chalice, letting me grab it. Now I return to the museum roof, which flies open. Out comes our main villain's henchmen, Dogman and Mander, guess which is which. They think their master will be pleased, but they also couldn't enter the tomb here, so they plan to return. A flying machine drops by to pick them up and flies off. But now I can enter the second part of the stage, Kensington, the tomb. Remember the last room of the museum before the boss? The hole the dinosaur made in the wall? This is the room I landed in, and I immediately miss my jump and lose a life bottle. The fall sets off four Anubis who managed to kill me. Good thing I was given the chance to save as I entered. I land the jump next time but run off the edge, avoiding hurting myself. I ignore the Anubis this time and just get climbing up the ladders instead. I grab the two money bags and stand out of reach of the Anubis and safely shoot them all to death. Killing them all opens the door to the tomb. Dan takes control and gets the torch out, showing that I can light the unlit ones. Running down the corridor, I find I can set an Anubis on fire to make them take constant damage. and run through the direction of the next room where I light all the torches first. In here are three stacks of boxes, one alone, and stacks of two and three in front of some higher up sections. I first push the stack of two to the stack of three and then the lone one against them to climb up and grab the Tablet of Horus. Then I stack them on the other end to grab the Scroll of Sekhmet before I leave the room on the other side. This final room has three statues. In the one left of the entrance I place the Tablet of Horus to make it shine a light into the middle of the room. In the one right of the entrance I place a Scroll of Sekhmet for the same result. But I'm missing an item for the third. In the previous room I forgot about the wall the lone crate was at, so I stack them all there so I can grab the Staff of Anubis. I place it on the statue opposite the entrance to the final room. A sarcophagus rises from the centre of the room to reveal an only slightly mummified woman. She falls out and Dan catches her, taking her with him as the level ends. That was another good one. I enjoyed the town part more than the museum though, and those Anubis guys are pricks. Back to the professor's lab. I hand over the chalice to regain the hammer from the first game. Now that's more like it. I talk to the professor properly to learn that Dan has managed to return power to this place. Then he pervs over the dead woman. Like, you know she's blue because she's dead, right? Dan explains what he saw at the museum through mime and hands over the pocket watch. Kif says he'll look into it as he stares directly at the woman's arse. Once again, dead. Under those wraps is possibly just decayed away. He just tells Dan to go out and get more power for his machines. Next level available is the freak show. We get a good view of his circus and I talk to Winston, who tells me that the imps are going crazy without their ringmaster. To the left is some money and to the right is a spot to heal. I cross the bridge and get attacked by bearded women who smack me with their guts. They can also belly slam the floor to create shockwaves. Killing the four here brings me to 7% for the chalice. There's gonna be a lot of enemies to kill here. I cross two more bridges, grab all the money here, and kill more bearded ladies to reach 12%. Instead of heading through the gate in front of me, I go left into a tunnel. This is where I can find the imps. Killing the two here bring me to 16%. Out of the other end is my second life bottle and a lot of money. I immediately lose a life bottle's worth of health failing to jump in time and drowning myself. It just takes me back to the beginning anyway, so I go back the way I came and head back to the Fountain of Rejuvenation. And here is what I consider to be the worst change from the original game. In the first, Fountains of Rejuvenation will refill once you leave the level, but in this game they stay permanently drained. I don't know why they did this other than to fuck the player over later in the game. I go through that gate which closes behind me for a magician to appear and make a giant ghost dragon start moving around the place. Like the Necromancer last level, I have to wait for this guy to blink into a hammerable state, then spend a bit dodging his dragon. Two cycles of this kills him, 19%. This opens a door going forward. More bearded ladies and imps. Imps are good at stun locking, so it's best to charge up the hammer shockwave attack while running from them. I also hammer the strongman to make it drop money just in time for some imps to get caught in the shockwaves. 34% by the time I'm done with them. Then setting off a smart bomb gets one in the far distance, then another bearded lady bringing me to 38%. Moving on, I find a pair of statues with holes for elephant keys. I enter the tent past them, which is filled with bearded ladies and another dragon guy, followed by a lot of imps. By the time I'm done, I'm at 58%. Killing them all also opens a door on the other side. Here I use a trampoline to reach an even higher level. Going to the left, Winston tells me that the imps are using the freak show to build an army of giant elephant bots. Alright. I keep going left until I reach another building. Killing all the enemies around here brings me up to 76%, and a few around the corner get me to 87%. I return to where I spoke to Winston and bounce across these trampolines over the water, thirst for some more money. Luckily, falling in doesn't take an entire life bottle. I bounce across to the other side, killing the imps also bouncing across to reach 94%. One more to kill gets me to 96% and I follow the path to a tunnel. Here I find the first elephant bot. Stamping their feet will cause earthquakes and it will shoot lasers out of its trunk. These are fought very similarly to the mecha imps from Scarecrow Fields in the first game. Run between the legs and keep shooting the unprotected imp in the back. It's 15 damage a shot with the pistol, so it takes a good amount of shots to kill. This buff fills up the chalice for me and gets me elephant key 1. I go back the way I came and drop down by that building I killed a load of imps by, continuing down the road into another tunnel that takes me to another elephant bot. It finds the same, so let's skip to me killing it and grabbing elephant key too. On the way back, I finally enter that building containing an unfinished elephant bot. I heal up, bounce up the trampoline, and find the chalice. I go back to the trampolines and bounce over close to this large tent. It's closed, but the slots for the elephant keys are in front of it, which will open it. Inside the tent, there's another elephant bot walking around, but this is the only one allowed a protective casing around the driver. Around the tent are these levers. I just need to stand by them and wait for the robot to walk by and time it so I drop a weight on top of the casing. An important detail is that once you hit it with a certain lever, that one cannot be used again. You'll have to run to a different one. Don't do it too early or you'll miss and the robot will turn around and walk the other way. This ends up a problem when there's just one lever left and I'm waiting ages for it to loop back around. I lose a lot of health and my entire shield from taking laser shots while waiting for it. It's not until my fourth try with the last lever that it finally hits and destroys the elephant bot. This opens the level exit. I heal outside the tent and take it, returning to the professor's lab. The chalice gets me the crossbow, better than the pistol since it fires quicker, but other than that it's basically the same as it was in the first game. Kith's been doing some research into the pocket watch I gave him and has figured out that the cause of all this is Lord Palethorn, a former member of the Magic Circle who got kicked out for messing with black magic. By this point the spell is affecting the entirety of London, raising all of its dead and setting off other demons. Also, the blue woman is called Kia, the 91st consort of Ramses, who was mummified and buried alive when he died. This was over 100 years before the events of the first game, and around 20 years before Dan died fighting Zarek's army. She doesn't have much to say other than being very thankful for being freed. Time for the next level, Greenwich Observatory. Winston says he heard something weird going on there, which is a good enough excuse to send Dan over. First thing I do is kill a single zombie. Then, taking a few steps further, a bird comes by and swipes Dan's head, but his body can still move. The head is taken to the bird's nest. Winston tells me I can swap between head and body with L1 and triangle, and when I reach my head again, those two buttons will make me put it back on. Swapping to the head right now is pointless though, since I can't move. I continue to follow the path, taking out more zombies. I actually end up going back to the small sword. Even though the hammer is stronger, it doesn't stun the zombies as long and can let them get some hits in. Gotta avoid bird shit too. By the time I've reached this gate at the end of the path, I fill the chalice to 23%. That shitting bird then takes like a million crossbow bolts before it goes down, 29%. Going through the gate takes me to the observatory. Winston tells me the entrance is barred, so I'll have to find another way to get in. He tells me I should check across the river. First I do a lap around the observatory to kill the zombies. I find a smart bomb to speed this up and a new copper shield to replace the one I lost. By the time I've killed them all, the chalice is at 43%. While I can't enter, I can climb a ladder near the entrance to find the bird that's got my head. I shoot it down and take my head back. Then behind the observatory, I take the tunnel to the next area. More zombies to kill here, getting me to 54%. At the first fork, I turn left and climb the ladder to this roof, then plant several bolts in this bird's arse. I climb another ladder for a much needed fountain of rejuvenation, but that's all for that way, so I go back to the fork and go right. It's here where a green squid thing will jump up and latch onto a headless corpse to take control. They'll jump around and spit purple shit at me. There are other zombies around, but killing them just opens up another potential body for when I beat the squid off its current one. Once it's off, I just hammer it to death, 65%. I can also smash up the lingering bodies with the hammer in case there are any others, as there is a little further on, along with another bird, followed by another squid right after, 76% by the time I'm done with them. As you can see, the river is drained around here, so I'd need to jump between these boats, but first I drop to the ground below to clear out the enemies and grab the money hidden around here. By the time I've killed them all, I've jumped up to 94%. I get back on the boat I dropped from and go around the back. I can see the chalice on another boat in the back, and around the back of this one is my third life bottle. I then enter that boat. There are four numbered switches with meters that fill when I hit them and a spot to place my head. Then I get stuck. Every time in my life I've played this level, I always get stuck at this part. I can never figure out what to do, and the solution is very simple. What I have to do is switch to my head and go in first person. This shows how many times I need to hit the switches. So I make them match, which lowers a bridge outside to another boat. I take my head back and head to that bridge. Two more squids drop down on the way so I can fully fill that chalice. I cross that bridge and get jumping across these boats until I reach a lever that raises a bridge to the other end of the river, but before I cross it, I jump across to the boat with the chalice and grab it. The bridge takes me to another boat and I can jump off at the other side, kill the enemies and follow the path to the end where there's money and Winston, who tells me I can't go back once I go through this door. But I have the chalice so it's fine. I go through the door to reach the Greenwich Naval Academy. I'm shown a building surrounded by zombies with cannons on the roof and a sort of dragon hot air balloon thing. While I try to clear out the enemies, another bird steals my head. Killing all the enemies puts me in a very bad state, but thankfully there's another fountain of rejuvenation nearby, but it doesn't really heal me by that much. I enter the building and clear that out of enemies too. I take the ramps up and out to the roof where the blue one is, and I can drop down and take my head back. I head back inside and halfway between the ground floor and the roof is another device to stick my head in. It will then sink into the acid where it can see an object down the bottom. On the ground floor are switches that make the magnet up top move in certain direction. I just have to use a sight from my head to line it up with the object and lower it to pull it out and grab myself the bellows. I take them to the balloon on the roof, put them in place, use a torch to light it and keep jumping on them to get moving and finish the level. I had a pain with the first puzzle, but this wasn't too bad. If anything, the enemies were a bigger pain than anything else. We cut to inside the observatory, with Dogman and Manda messing with a telescope, when Palethorn shows up. Manda has tinkered with it to show them the locations of all the remaining spellbook pages. They start the machine, but Dan crashes through the roof on the hot air balloon, completely destroying the telescope. Palethorn leaves the other two to deal with Dan. Mandy will try and keep a distance firing lasers, while Dogman will just run in close to punch me. There's a room in the back I can hide in to heal and buy from the spiv. I try to keep a distance myself and keep spamming the charged shockwave from the hammer to hit them without needing to get too close. I manage to defeat Dogman with this, but doing so grants Mando super speed. So he's always running all over, creating shockwaves, firing projectiles and twirling into me. I just take the hits and repeat my strategy until he's defeated too. I can finally leave and return to the professor's lab. This time the chalice gets me the axe. Like in the first game, it can also be thrown. Knowing that Paleform doesn't yet have all the pages is the best news we could give the professor. They just have to get the rest of the pages before him. Next level is Kew Gardens, which is where Winston has traced Paleform. We get a cutscene with Paleform's crew. They manage to locate one page of the book before Dan destroyed the telescope. He's not happy to hear that Dan escaped. I quite like that Paleform just sounds like some guy. Like, the acting isn't amazing or anything, but he just sounds so calm most of the time, and I think it works. It does mean he doesn't quite have the presence that Zarek did, though. We see him pull a lever, which sets a pumpkin monster onto some poor civilian. When I start, Winston tells me that mutated plants have taken over the entire area. First I go right and get ran over by a giant pumpkin before I grab the potting shed key. Taking the left path has me dodging a couple more rolling pumpkins and finding my fourth life bottle. Here the mutated pumpkins start attacking me. As I kill them, you can see I already have a good chunk of the chalice already filled in. If you remember the first game, you know what that means. These lot also drop antidotes when killed. We'll get to those in a bit. Killing this lot leaves me at 48%. Following the path also gets me smaller rolling pumpkins and ones that try to run at me, but these don't count towards the chalice. I run past the front door of the main building to grab some money, kill two pumpkins and unlock the potting shed. In here I grab the water tank valve and now I can enter the main building. Winston lets me know of humans being turned into pumpkins when they get attacked by the mutants. Yeah, this is why I start with some of the chalice filled. Gotta keep people alive or their deaths will lower my percentage. I have to use the antidote on infected humans to keep them alive. A little like the good lightning in the final level of the first game. So I jump down and do a very bad job keeping them alive. My blindly throwing the axe to hit any enemies doesn't help and I end up taking out a couple grannies myself. When I kill a third guy myself, I decide to quit and restart the level. Next time I put the antidote to use and I just barely save all three people. This has me at 60%. I can climb the giant leaves back up to the first floor. There's a ladder in that section but I can't get to it yet, so instead I take the door in the back to the next room. Across from the entrance is another door, but it's blocked by a flower spitting fireballs at me. There's another room off to the left, but first I jump down below to heal, grab some money and fight some pumpkins. By the time I'm done, I'm at 66% and I go through that tunnel to the left. There are more innocents to save here and more pumpkins to keep them safe from. The main reason it can be a pain is because the two are on opposite ends of the room, and they always tend to have at least two crowding around them ready to reinfect them the second you cure them. It ends up leaving me with no other choice than to let one of them die to save the other. I don't have to save them all, just not lose enough I can't fill the chalice. Although even that becomes a pain because the survivor now has 4 or 5 crowding around her. By the time I'm done, I'm at 72%. I think 6% was lost to that dude dying. I climb this tree until I can jump off at a higher level, but go for some money, miss and lose an entire life bottle. Next time I get the money and climb even higher to find the chalice is at the top of this tree. I jump off onto the top section of the room to find more spitting plants and go through the door. This puts me on the outside of the building. I just have to climb and jump until I reach the roof where there's even more money to grab. On the other end is a huge stationary pumpkin that starts moving when I get close for some cheap hits. I go through the door it unblocked. In here there's a spot to place the water tank valve. It sets the sprinklers off which makes all the spitting plants in the first room open up to create platforms, but not in any later rooms. So I return to that room and use the plants to reach the ladders that take me up to the highest part of the room where I can grab the pond room valve. The water also made a couple more pumpkins come to life, getting me to 76%. The pond room is the one with the giant tree. I climb it and near the plants is a spot to place that valve, opening the plants in this room and the previous room. Climbing them gets me the hothouse valve. Jumping across the plant in the previous room takes me to a door to another room. Once again I have to fight the pumpkins while keeping people alive. This time I kill them all without anyone dying, getting me to 86%. This room is the hothouse, so I can place that valve. I can climb the plants in here to the next room, but there's also another door to the side of the entrance that I take first. It's the room from the cutscene where we see Paleform get that guy killed. In here I can grab my fifth life bottle. Now I can take that other exit. The next room has a chest that lets me regain the silver shield. This is the higher section of that last room I was in, where Paleform and Mando were talking. First I have to dodge a load of bouncing pumpkins, then the actual walking ones get involved. At least there's a fountain I can use during this. Although it doesn't help much when a boulder pumpkin rolls on me while I'm healing. During this I manage to 100% fill up the chalice. After a long fight, one of the giant ones rolls into the exit and breaks it open so I can leave. So I backtrack and grab the chalice so I can finally finish this level. Not a bad level, but the moments where I'm defending people are a pain thanks to the way the enemies work. If this game gets a remaster like the first, making those parts less annoying would be much appreciated. But thanks to it, it is my least favourite level so far, and probably second least favourite in the entire game. Back to the professor's lab where he and Kia are nowhere to be seen. Instead, Winston's waiting for me. In exchange for the chalice, the professor has made me some bombs. We're not told right away, but we're already in a new level called Dankenstein. There's a room opposite the projector which is where the professor and Kia are. Palethorn is about to launch an attack and has made a giant monster to take them on. So the professor is going to make his own using Kia's knowledge of embalming. He already has a head, somehow, and needs me to go gather the limbs for him. I have 8 minutes to do this, but time is kind enough to freeze to me while I read an entry in the professor's diary from a year earlier. Last year he found a way to reanimate several amputated body parts that then mutated into monsters, and he released them into the underground for his own safety. He concluded that the experiment was a failure until he met Kia, and this leads to now. Back in the main room, the door to the right of the projector is open. So in this room with the demon train moving around, there are several mutants that will drop the professor's reanimated limbs when I kill them. I kill the one with the right arm and take that. A limb has less than 20 seconds to be taken back to the professor before it spoils and I have to find another. However, grabbing a new limb resets the timer, but makes me drop the first limb I was carrying. I take the right arm back to the professor and place it on the slab. In the same area I found the last limb, I find my 6th life bottle in the corner and grab a right leg. I place that one and while killing, looking for my next limb, I've already filled the chalice. In the left corner of the room nearest to the door, I grab myself a left arm and take that back. Then in the same spot I grab a left leg, just 2 left. Now it's time to get on the train tracks and follow them up to a tunnel. I follow the tracks some more back into the lab, but when I stop to fix the camera, I lose a lot of time from a train knocking me off the tracks and taking a life bottle. Thermal damage is another new thing by the way, not in the first. I get back up and jump across some platforms in the walls to find some more money and the chalice. Back near the tracks there's some spidery mutant that when killed drops a torso. Fun fact, as a child it was this level that taught me the word torso. With that I have just over 3 minutes to get the last part. The last mutant is on a cart along the train tracks. I kill it and take the bum. Why was he reanimating severed arses? Is this why he was also checking out Kia's? What the fuck is this guy's deal? Whatever, it's placed and the body is complete. The professor starts taking the head towards it, but drops it, breaking open the case and ruining it. But he has another idea and just sticks Dan's head on top. I liked that. After the pain Kew Gardens was, it was nice for a slightly more brainless level, but now we have Iron Slugger. So it turns out that Palethorn was just challenging us to a boxing match. Things don't look too good for Dankenstein, as he has 0 wins, while Iron Slugger has 40 straight wins and weighs 160 pounds more. That and he's clearly a machine while I'm just some recycled flesh. A round is 45 seconds long and my 4 buttons are now left and right jabs and hooks. Thing is, Iron Slugger doesn't get stunned like I do, and he has longer arms than me. I can block, but that only does me so much when he punches my left arm off. And my right leg, which slows my movement. Taking both my arms only leaves me able to hit with my head. Between rounds, I have 20 seconds to chase imps to get my limbs back and recover a bit of health. I'm not even allowed to get all 3 back as I'm still missing a leg. I don't last much longer as he smashes everything else off me and finishes me off by knocking my head off. The cutscene has Palethorn intending to take Kia as a prize. None of these people have acknowledged she's dead, have they? Second time, I get it, but my main strategy was just to hold the shoulder button and spam uppercuts, hoping to stunlock him. I end the first round having done more damage and having lost less limbs, so I start the second round with more health. He gives me a good beating at the start, but I manage to knock off his left arm to make things a little easier. Once you take out a single arm, he becomes a lot more manageable and I take out the left leg too. I get 2 of the 3 limbs I lost back again between rounds and knock his other arm off to learn he has a rapid headbutt of his own, leaving us with just a single limb, hopping around and swinging our heads at each other. At this point I just hobble away and wait the round out until I can get 2 limbs back and get a proper advantage for the 4th round. He starts by headbutting my left leg off, but then I punch his off too. Then I lose an arm but trap him in the corner, punching those little bits out of him until his head goes flying off and lands at Palethorn's feet. He rants for a bit and just walks off. It can be a bit tricky at first, but it was a neat diversion, and if you don't like it, at least you only have to do it this one time. Back in the lab, I hand over my chalice to have my small sword permanently upgraded to the broadsword. Like in the first game, it's enchanted but limited and I need to pay to have the enchantment topped up. The professor is picking up 2 psychic disturbances, one in Whitechapel and an even stronger one elsewhere. Kia says she wants to check out one of them, but Dan thinks it's too dangerous. Kia's already spent 600 years in a tomb and doesn't want to spend all her time out of it still stuck underground. So Kia will go to Whitechapel while Dan checks out the other. Being Iron Slugger will also allow me to enter Dan Hand mode, where I can place Dan's head on these green hands that have been all over the place all game, which will allow me to find new areas in old levels. And those new areas are what I'll be leaving this episode on. I was going to cover the next level in this video, but I wanted to equalise both parts of this game. If I cover the next one in this video, part 1 would be about 2/3 to 3/4 of the game. Right at the beginning of the museum, in the first corridor, is a small hole to send Danhand into. In here there's a load of boxes to jump across to reach a lot of money. At the end is another room with more boxes and pipes where I can find another fountain of rejuvenation to drain, along with even more money. After grabbing it all, there's a hole that puts me back in the corridor. Next one can be found inside the tomb in the Kensington level, in the first room. Just 2 more lots of money and another fountain. Next are holes in certain tents in the freak show. Avoiding imps and bouncing up trampolines to free more chests of money. The other hole in the tent teleports me further into the level. In Greenwich Observatory, in the river is a hole in one of the boats, jumping across craters in water to find 3 more money chests and another fountain. Another hole in the hothouse in Kew Gardens. It leads me to a maze where there are 4 other hands I need to rescue while dodging pumpkins. It's very simple, I just keep moving left and the maze is laid out in a way that I can cover it all easily just doing that. To save a hand, I just have it follow me and drop it off in a hole in the middle. Saving them all gets me 3 more money chests on top of the one I found while exploring this place. The last one is in Dankenstein. Below the entrance to the main room with the mutants is another hole. Another fountain and 2 more money chests. To be honest, I think they kind of wasted this idea. I like the idea of Danhand opening up more areas and old levels, but there's nothing interesting to find in them. Just more money and health, which shouldn't have been so limited in the first place. At least put one of the life bottles in one of these so the backtracking is worth it. But yeah, that's where I'm leaving it for this episode. Next episode we'll continue by checking out that disturbance the professor found. Despite some annoyances, this game is still quite fun. I haven't yet reached the point that made me think, fuck this game or anything. But we're just over halfway through, so we'll see if that changed by the end of the game next episode. Closing out the episode, I'll be finishing off MediEvil 2. The next level to check out is Wulfrum Hall, where the professor is picking up a huge psychic disturbance. Before the level starts, we check in on Palethorn and his henchmen, talking about Dan. Manda bringing up him beating Iron Slugger pisses Palethorn off and he punches Manda flying out of the hovercraft. He decides to call on some allies. He tells a guy speaking over his radio that it's time for his arrival before he leaves. I start out in front of the gate across from the hall. Winston tells me that the entrance is guarded and that I'll need to find another way in by using the hands. The front door requires a key and ringing the doorbell doesn't get me in either. Dropping down to the left gets me some money while dropping down to the right shows me an open window. I put my head on a nearby hand and run through it. It drops me into a kitchen where I can see a key on the table, but I get caught by a Renfield and thrown back out. Next time I grab the key, but he catches me again. Getting caught will take the key from you. Several failed attempts and many beatings later, I grab the key and stand on this switch to lower the shaft and then ride it up to the next floor. I go through the nearby door into this big dining room. The next door then puts me in the main hall, behind the front door where I can see the chalice above a table. Instead, I take the door opposite the one I entered from. I get this creepy girl pick me up and throw me around before I can climb these boxes to get on top of these bookshelves and follow them along to this window back outside. I return to my body and now I can unlock the front door and enter. Right away I'm attacked by 5 of those suits of armour I fought in the museum. Killing them all gets me to 29% of the chalice filled. I smash open these wooden boards blocking an exit opposite the front door and jump through into another room. Those little girls can't be killed. Launching an axe into their faces just knocks them out for a bit. I head upstairs and find Winston, who tells me the place is filled with vampires that are immune to all my weapons, so I need another method of killing them. I take out the Renfield up here, grab some money, and take the open door on the right of Winston. I ignore the stairs at first to follow the hallway to my 7th life bottle. I then run up those stairs and take out another Renfield for 41% of the chalice filled. I can't do anything else in here yet, so I go back to the previous room and take the door to the right of this one. The door closes behind me and I can see 2 coffins with sleeping vampires inside. I break open the boards in front of the windows to shine light on one coffin. The vampire bursts out on fire and chases me for a bit before it dies. I do the same thing with the other, which opens the door and the one to the left of Winston. The chalice is also at 58%. I go through that door, which also closes behind me and leaves me in another room filled with more coffins. First I run to the other end of the room to open the window and push the nearby coffin into it to kill the vampire. For the second, I drop into this gap and push the crate to the edge so I can push the coffin on top of it. I pull the crate to the other end and put the coffin in the light. Door reopens, door to the left of this one opens, and chalice is at 76%. Go through the last door, which also closes behind me. Grab the nearby money and run up the stairs to heal. I jump across these platforms to open another window. This time the light splits and shines on 3 spots. The coffins are below the platforms and I just have to push them into those spots. However, the green tiles on this floor ring a bell that wakes the vampires, so I have to stay away and wait for them to fall asleep again. The last one is smart and manages to avoid the light. But there's this long crate nearby I can push to box him into the light and finish him. This opens a door back in the room next to Winston where I killed that Renfield. It also got the chalice to 94%. Through it is another door that closes behind me. This time the room has some crates, a lift and a small wall to trap things in. First I ride the lift up and open the window. Then I jump around the room across all the floorboards sticking out of the walls. I reach his coffin and push it down to the bottom of the floor to make it break open. Same with the second next to it. Using the crates I have to lure them between the little walls, then out the other end and onto the lift where they'll be lifted into the light and burned to death. Killing the first heals the chalice. Killing the second opens the door out and the door next to the one leading to this room. I grab the chalice and go through that new door. This one also closes behind me. I follow the path I enter on, past the door, leading to a closed door and another window to open. I leave that room and drop down to find some money next to three more coffins. To the left is a tunnel leading to a switch that raises the chandelier up in front of that open window and reflects light back down. I try pushing a coffin into that room, but hit a tile that sets off another bell. I avoid it next time and push the coffin down into the chandelier room, which breaks it open. I raise it again for the light and kill the vampire. I then do it again with the other two, which opens the door next to the window. On the way, I go through the door I missed and heal to see a map that shows all the tiles that set off the bells that I could have looked at beforehand. I go through the final door which takes me to the boss level, the Count. After saving with Winston, I go through another door and jump down into the middle of the room. A huge coffin opens to reveal the Count. This was the guy talking to Palethorn over the radio. He spends ages going through his introduction and posturing, leaning to Dan just telling him to hurry up. The Count doesn't like to be interrupted and starts a fight. He spits a load of massive projectiles at me, he can also dash towards me and attack with his claws. Around the arena are four mirrors that both my attacks and his can rotate. I need to have the mirror up perfectly straight and then have the projectile hit it to reflect it back into the Count. He'll follow up some of these by throwing flaming bats at me. They're quite hard to avoid so most of them hit me. After the next hit he starts throwing Victoria Molotov cocktails around the arena. Once I hit him enough, we get another cutscene where he's writhing in pain, somehow opens up the windows and lets light into the room. He also takes on his second form. He stops throwing his projectiles and focuses on dashing and lobbing bats. I have to have all four mirrors aimed upwards at once so that they all reflect the light from above. Can be difficult as most of his attacks can also rotate the mirrors. But when I do get all four, they reflect onto the chandelier and set him alight, dealing huge damage to him. Doing it once more defeats him. He burns to death and explodes. Wulfrum Hall is more fun than I remembered it being. I think as a kid, I had a hard time even getting inside. It's not the best level and most of it is essentially an extended box pushing puzzle, but it's still fine. Back in the professor's lab, the chalice gets me the lightning. Like the first game, it's limited use and can never be refilled, so I never use it. However, the professor has lost contact with Kia since she went to investigate the second psychic disturbance. The professor is worried because it was he who was all for letting her go. So the next level has us looking for her in Whitechapel. The professor warns Dan that someone has been collecting magic energy in that area as well. I start off in a cemetery and get attacked by zombies rising from the ground. There's a couple buildings here but nothing else I can do right now. There's also a smart bomb that wipes out a load of zombies for me. By the gate, Winston tells me that people he asked told him that Kia was last seen entering a nightclub. He warns me that the area is under curfew but he doesn't know why. This place is pretty small, but by the time I've cleared it out, I already have the chalice at 83%. Once I've killed them all, I go through the gate into town. Within seconds, I already have the police swarming me. They're invincible so I can't kill them. The club is right across from the gate, but the doorman won't let me in without a membership card. I head off to the right and then left at the next turn. It takes me to some more zombies that get me up to 94%. There's some ladders on a wall, so I push a crate up so I can grab on and climb them to this roof, leading to a window I can jump through. In this house, there's a fountain to heal some of the damage done by those bastard policemen. I go downstairs to find a locked door requiring a library key, then go even further down to find a small tunnel to send my head through, some money, and the library key hidden in some crates. Through the hole is a switch that moves the bookshelf higher up to reveal another item. It's a griffin shield and I use the library key to open the door and go through. In here we can read up on some toy inventor who was killed by his latest toy and is buried within Whitechapel Cemetery. Up the ladder is his club membership card. I leave the house and head back to the club, but I'm still not let in because Dan doesn't have a beard like the picture on the card. Never mind the lack of flesh or lower jaw or right eye, does this guy not know of the existence of shaving? I return to one of the buildings in the cemetery and place the griffin shield in one of the slots on the walls. Back in town I go left twice, then take the first right into an alley, then go left again to kill more zombies and fill up the chalice. I take the next right which leads to the chalice so I can grab it. I exit the path on the other side and keep going right, around this fence until I see this building I can enter. Inside a chest in here is the flaming crossbow. The longbow and its variants didn't return, so the fiery arrows carried over to the crossbow instead. I ignore the park inside this fence for now and return near the club, taking the path left and right at the turn from it. This leads me to another house I can enter where I can heal. I keep following the path until I can enter this shop and then go into the basement. Breaking all the boxes just gets me some money, and I go up some more stairs into a tailor's. I go into the changing room and come out in a suit. Still no beard though. I like this look for Dan though. Apparently he wasn't in PlayStation All-Stars when I got interested in what costumes were included. Which is a shame, but I don't think I want to cut any of the costumes that were included either. I leaf through the front door and return to that fenced-in park. There's a statue and three projectors all beaming the colour red. Each one has a switch next to it that changes the colour. I make the one on the right green and the one on the left blue, step on the block in front of the statue to lower it, then hit all three projectors until they face the box in the middle, to combine the lights and open a hole in front of the statue containing the unicorn shield. I return to the cemetery and place it in the wall of that building to open the door inside. I get attacked by a load of zombies that killing opens a coffin for a necromancer to come out. I deal with him and even more zombies to open my way back out and grab a beard from the coffin. With this on my skull I can finally enter that club, the doorman not questioning me using the card of a dead man. Inside there's a woman to talk to. She's already met and spoken to Kia. She's warned Kia of Jack the Ripper and Kia's response has been to try and find him. She tells Dan to hurry to the clock tower and gives him the 8th life ball. The door to the clock tower opens. It's near the park I got the unicorn shield. As a kid, I wasn't expecting Jack the Ripper to be involved, but it's one of those things that as you get to it, it just makes perfect sense. I head through the door to find Kia cornered by Jack the Ripper, who's basically Freddy Krueger. But it's too late and he impales Kia on his claws and drains away her life force. We literally see the red soul stuff that comes out when you kill an enemy. The Ripper escapes and when Dan checks on Kia, she fades away. He's very upset. I think Whitechapel is my favourite level in the game. The police are a pain, but it has an atmosphere that feels closest to the first game. I also can't help but love the fact that we go on this big item collecting quest which involves grave robbing just for a fake beard. Dan's sudden romantic interest in Kia is out of nowhere though, considering he's barely spoken to her. It's been like, what, one line? And he really is upset about her death. On returning to the professor's lab, Dan lets him know that Kia is dead. Kif blames himself for about 2 seconds.
Dead.
Oh no, she's dead and it's all my fault. I'll never be able to forgive myself. Anyway,
He's picking up signals from the cathedral, but Dan's so depressed that he quits. Kif tries to talk him out of it, saying that Paleform will get control of London and then the entire British Empire. But Dan doesn't care and is fine to let him have it. This leads to the next level, the sewers. Right away, for getting the chalice next level, Winston delivers me the blunderbuss. Nowhere to go but to drop down this hole in the tracks into the sewer proper. There's this guy, a mullock, wielding a spear. He leads me to an animal being controlled by one of the squid things from Greenwich. When I finally kill it, they open a nearby door for me. I follow the cave to what looks like a small village. There's a house that has a statue of Dan on top of it. It looks to be the same one from the title screen of the first game. The King Mullock is even wearing a helmet that resembles Dan's skull and bows before him, believing Dan to have been sent to save them.
Well, Great One, you see, we were once a happy tribe, singing and dancing. That was until the great beast came and lured away all our women. Now the only song we sing is a sad one. We have lost the taste for battle.
Yeah, sad story and all, but why are the sewer people Northern? What makes you think we even had the money to live in a sewer? He also mentions owning a time stone, which will be important. Next to the king is a chest that lets me get back the gold shield. I go to the opposite end of the room to heal at the fountain. I then take the nearby tunnel to the next screen. There's some money and more squids in here. That's 3 enemies killed and the chalice is already at 54%. I take another tunnel into the next room where I place my head on a hand to trigger the appearance of 2 more squids. Without my head on, they can latch onto my body for continuous damage. Killing them gets me to 90% and I can take my head through this tiny hole in the door. I jump across some pipes to a tunnel with a switch next to it that opens that door so I can bring my body through. I follow the tunnel to the other end where I can take my head up these boxes to a smaller tunnel to enter. It takes me to a room with a pipe puzzle. Can't do much right now other than leave my head in the tiny bit of pipe available to me. I then take my body through the door into a part of the room with a lever. Hitting it changes the positions of all the pipes, connecting the one my head is in to another. I move my head into the next pipe and hit the lever again 3 more times to connect this one to the last pipe. I move my head into that one and 3 more hits is enough to get my head out on the other side. There's a switch that rearranges all the pipes onto the ground to make a bridge for my body to a ladder that takes me back to my head. I then climb the nearby ladder for more money and another tunnel. In this one, at the first fork, I go left to have Winston tell me to see what the spiff is selling. He gives me a poster. It's hard to tell, but the poster has a time machine on it. Further in, I see a mullock woman being dragged off by a tentacle. Then a tentacle with a mouth comes out and spits fireballs at me. I get a few hits in with the axe before it recedes and comes out another hole. Repeat until it's dead, freeing the woman and having the game let me know there are 4 left. I return to the tunnel I was just in and head to the other end where I can jump out onto a pipe. Here I see another woman caught by a tentacle. This time the holes are more spread out but there's only 2 of them so it's easy. That's 3 women left to save. And the next one isn't too far away, just on the opposite end of the wall. And there's only one hole this time. Two left. I dropped at the bottom of this room, forgetting about that annoying fall damage. There's another squid down here to kill that fills the chalice. Nearby there's another tunnel that drops me next to a bell. I ring it for the ferryman to refuse me. Up the stairs reveals this is one of the four exits from the village. This just leaves a tunnel next to the king as the only one I haven't checked out yet. Following this bridge down gets me another chance to heal. I can't remember the last time I've had more than half of my maximum health. Once I reach the bottom, there's two more of those cow things from earlier. I have to lead it to this wall and hit it to make it break open. It takes me to the fourth tentacle with two holes it's lost between. Just one woman left to save. Going through the next door takes me to more cows being possessed by squids. Once I kill the squids, I had them break down another wall, but first I climb the ladder next to it to find my ninth life bottle. Then I go through that door to find the final tentacle. I kill it to save the last woman. There's a hand here, so I send my head through the hole in the back for the chalice. The other two holes just take me between the holes other tentacles used. Back in the last room, I climb the ladder again for a shortcut back to the village. I return to the king, who asks if Dan will stay to defend them from future attacks. But Dan's vented his sadness, so he's ready to go back to the surface. The king sends me back to the water with two money chests. Now when I ring the bell, the ferryman will come collect me. I jump on to end the level. That was a fun level. It is a bit weird to follow Kia's death with a sewer adventure, but I feel following her death with a level that's about succeeding in saving women is an intentional choice. Back in the lab, I can enter the professor's room in the back. Kith tries to talk Dan back into stopping Palethorn, but Dan instead asks about the poster. He says it was one of his earliest experiments, but it was a waste of time and doesn't work. Dan's going to go try it anyway. Kith tries to talk him out of it, but when Dan gets pissed off, he gives in and tells the truth. He talks about how he and Palethorn were friends before the expedition that led to him losing his hands. He also knew Palethorn was behind the spell all along. The time machine is in the museum, but he could still never get it to work. But by this point, Dan's already gone off. This puts us straight into the time machine and, someone accidentally put a spoiler in the loading screen. He's not supposed to be wearing that yet. Forgetting the chalice in the sewers, I'm delivered the magic sword. Now I can finally replace the axe and have this as my main melee weapon. So yeah, we're back in the museum. Behind one of these statues is a money chest and I go left of the stairs through a door that was closed before. The suits of armour return, but these ones are a new colour, and it looks like there's no chalice as killing them doesn't add to any percentage. I then move ahead into the next room. From the entrance I go left and take the first door into a room with the Celestial Grammar Horn, made so the Empire can blast the national anthem out into space. I gotta be honest, I thought the idea was so ridiculous it couldn't be made up. Someone back then had to have at least suggested something like this, but I couldn't find anything. I leave it for now and go to the next room along to see a moonbase exhibit with a rocket, then believing Britain would own the moon by 1910. There are three buttons that each make an alien pop out of one of the craters. I once again leave and check the final room, which contains a time machine I'm looking for. But it doesn't work, so I return to the room I fought the armors, go down the stairs where I can heal, and then go through the door there. There's this mock radio tower I can send my head into through a hole. Climbing to the top of the steps, I can jump across these moving satellites to grab a time machine piece. I return to the Grammarhorn room, where the floor turns out to be a simple memory game. Standing on the tiles in the order they light up, and after getting several right, a UFO will drop down from the ceiling and give me my second time machine piece. Finally, back to the moon room. I have to stand on one of the switches, then send my head through a crack in the glass case. I stand in front of the rocket, let the alien shoot at me, and then move out of the way to blow up a section of the rocket. Doing so also kills the alien, so I need to move on to the next one. Have all three aliens shoot the rocket and I can grab the final time machine piece. I return to the time machine and use all three time machine pieces on it to get it working. The time machine gets moving, kicking off part 2 of this level, Time Machine Sewers. We haven't time travelled yet, we're still in the present. The Mullocks are still here and the level layout is pretty much the same until I reach the village. The building in the middle I can now enter. I drop down a hole in there to find the time stone that the king mentioned last time I was here. This lowers a cage on me. Some hands drop through the ceiling so I can have my head escape by jumping through a hole in the wall. As I try to find my way around, Mullocks will try stabbing me with their spears. I can take a ramp that puts me outside the king's house and on the opposite side of the village is another fountain to heal with. I go back into the building where Winston tells me that now I have the time stone and the Mullocks hate me to get back to the time machine. I jump in this fireplace where there's a switch to raise a cage trapping my body. It also opens another door in the dungeon. I return to my body, knock out the Mullock and escape through the door. I take the path back to the river where Winston lets me know that the Mullocks have taken the time machine and that only wearing the king's hat can summon the boat to the island they've put it on. I beat up a Mullock outside the king's house which makes the king himself come out and heal that Mullock using the good lightning from the final level of the first game. I take the chance to knock out the king and take the key to his house. I run through into the back room and into this wardrobe where I can take the good lightning for myself and change into the king's clothes. Now the Mullocks will leave me alone despite standing right next to their defeated king, and I go back to the river to call the boat to the time machine. With the machine fixed up and the time stone obtained, I can finally move through time. This starts part 3 of the level, Time Machine the Ripper. Before I start the fight, there's a fountain to heal with and the spiff so I can prepare. Dan charges at the Ripper, but he still manages to impale Kia. But Dan did get there early enough to distract him from absorbing her life. For this fight, both the Ripper and Kia have a life bar. If Kia takes damage, I'll need to use the good lightning to give up some of my health to heal her. He stays invincible while running around or dashing into me while slashing with his claws. He only becomes tangible when he goes to attack Kia, which is when I can damage him. After that, he does this long dash jump between walls from the top to the bottom of the screen. It can be very hard to avoid thanks to the speed of it. Even the daring dash doesn't work too well at keeping you out of his range. I just keep repeating this pattern until I get him down to 30 health. At that point, he starts making fireballs rain down from the sky. Another tough dodge thanks to the size of the explosions. The next time he goes for Kia, I get him down to 1 health. He cuts me off with his wall dash, but next time he becomes solid, I get the final hit in. The Ripper begs for mercy. Instead, Dan executes him with a shot to the head. The Ripper had gathered enough souls that killing him alone gets Dan a chalice. Kia and Dan embrace as past Dan from the Whitechapel level shows up. The two shake hands, which makes them merge into a single Dan, now wearing golden armour. For a level that's entirely revisiting old areas, this was a fun one. The museum had new things to look around, and while the sewers was more for plot than gameplay, it was short enough to be an enjoyable diversion. Then getting to execute Drag the Ripper is a cool climax. Back to the professor's lab, handing over the final chalice gets a monster of the weapon, the Gatling gun. We stayed in the past when we saved Kia, so from this professor's point of view, Dan just left the Whitechapel and is returning with Kia and the armour. I just don't get how Dan can kiss Kia back what with not having a mouth. I also don't get why you'd want to in front of someone who looks like that. The professor tries to explain the signal he's picking up from cathedral spires, but Dan already knows all this. The professor notices that Dan's new armour is made from the same material as the gold shield. The armour provides protection from all damage to a certain point. After the gold bar around your health is depleted, you lose the armour and take health damage until you pay the spiff to repair it. And now it's time to move on to the final level, Cathedral Spires, where Palethorn is hoping to find the last few pages of Zarek's spellbook. The camera pans to show the giant climb I'm going to have to do. Winston tells me that the cathedral is being powered by imprisoned souls that I'll have to free. I grab some money to the right and all the way to the left is the first of the 12 souls. I climb the nearby ladder, grab some more money off to the side and head towards the next ladder while having fire spat at me from demons. Then surprise, there's molten metal pouring down the ladder that you can't see, so you have to work out the timing. Even with my armour, the metal still knocks me off the ladder. The armour also doesn't protect me from fall damage. So I go to the ladder on the right side, which just takes me to the spiff so I can buy some repairs. I finally make it up the ladder for more demons to burst from the gargoyles. A few sword slashes will do. I next have to avoid the fire being breathed from these other gargoyles. It leads to more money and another ladder with another cauldron pouring metal. To the right is more money and a silver shield refill. To the left is avoiding more fire breathing gargoyles over a much narrower space. But I keep failing the timing and get knocked off, using up all my remaining money to repair my armour. It takes a couple more attempts to get through, at which point I lose my armour protection to a demon. I manage to climb another ladder where I take on two more demons with the Gatling gun, but die. I hate this level. I had issues with Kew Gardens, but this one drives me mad so much more. Annoying tight timing sections with the metal and fire that feels like the collision is dodgy. The lake was my least favourite level in the first game thanks to that chalice glitch, but this is my least favourite of the two games I've played. The other issue is that after my armour runs out, the Ripper left me with very little health and I've already exhausted all the fountains of rejuvenation in the game. I still don't know why they changed it so they never refilled like they did in the first game. Back at the point I died, I kill the demons and find the second soul nearby. I head forward to find two more rooms off to each side. I go in the left room first to save the third soul. The door then closes behind me and I get attacked by three demons. Killing them all opens a door. I then try the room on the right, where I save the fourth soul and the same thing happens. During this, I lose my armour protection. Once I'm back out, I continue the path forward. As I reach the ladder on this tower, I instead run around the back of it to find another room. I finally found a fountain that only fills up two of my 9 life bottles. The spiff is here so I can refill some of my armour too. Now I can start climbing that ladder. This ladder is a little confusing and all over the place, but while climbing I find the 10th life bottle next to the 5th soul. I reach the top of the tower, grab the money behind it, and go through the door. This leads to part 2, Cathedral Spires the Descent. At least now I can save, the absolute worst part of the level is behind me. I jump onto the chandelier with a lever on it that lowers a little when hit. Lowering it twice lets me jump off to the left for the 6th soul, getting half of them. The lever here will just bring the chandelier back to this height if for some reason it's not there. Across the other side is another soul, but I jump too early and lose a life bottle when I fall to the bottom. It turns out the problem is that the chandelier always sways when you land on it, so I miss again and lose another life bottle. I somehow fail the jump a third time and just reset the level, fuck it. I fail the jump again, but this time it doesn't lift me back up, so I have to call down the chandelier to the bottom and ride it back up. This time I finally get my 7th soul. I lower myself down to the bottom and take out all the suits of armour. There are two doors down here and I take the one closest to the lever. It lets me grab my eighth soul, which makes wolves burst out of these statues. They're a bit like the Anubis from Kensington, able to fire lasers, but with the magic sword, they're much easier to kill. When the door unlocks, I then take the other door. There are some platforms moving along by ropes, but first I drop down to the bottom of this room and enter the door there. I grab my ninth soul, which closes the door once more and gets me attacked by more wolves. I can also pick up the 11th and final life bottle in the game. Once I can go through the door, it takes me to another much needed fountain. But first I return to the room with the platforms. I ride them across to the other side and take the door for some more money and the spiv. Lowering a chandelier and then riding it up allows me to find a golden cog. Then I miss the jump yet again and lose another life bottle. Even inside, I still hate this level. Back in the previous room, I ride a platform to a ladder that takes me up into the rafters. After gunning down a particularly dickish demon, I run along the rafters to my 10th and 11th souls. Then on the opposite end is the final lost soul. I return to that room I last healed in and place the golden cog into this machine. Hitting the switch will then rotate the next room. I go into said room and up the stairs into the next. There's a hole here for me to send my head down. It has my head jumping across various cogs and platforms, grabbing a second golden cog on the way. The last cog sends me flying back to the room I placed the first golden cog. I rotate the second room twice more, allowing me to reach the next set of cogs and place a second golden cog. I return this room to the way it was last so that I can now reach the switch to rotate the room with the hole. I rotate it three times to gain access to a ladder to a fourth room. There's a demon in here that all of the lost souls will gang up on and defeat, allowing Dan to grab the spell page. But then the cathedral begins to crumble, giving me 60 seconds to escape the way I came. Using the daring dash is recommended to avoid taking damage from the boulders dropping from above. However, I make too many minor mistakes and run out of time, right in front of the exit. The place collapses, taking me with it. But the game is merciful here and just lets me start the escape again. This time I escape with 5 seconds left. The one spire explodes, taking out the rest of the cathedral with it. This kicks off the final part of this level, the demon. Walking through the ruins of the cathedral, I have one last chance to heal and stock up from the spiv. I drop down to have Palefawn show up and steal the last page. He gives Dan one last chance to replace Dogman and Mander at his side, even offering to give him his old flesh body back. But Dan isn't having it, so Palefawn sends Dogman and Mander to take him on while he deciphers the page. This fight is similar to the first fight with these two. Mander has super speed and projectiles, Dogman has ground shockwaves and can make you dizzy from a single punch. I use the same strategy I used last time, running around swinging my sword, hoping they'll walk into it. I kill Dogman first, for real this time. I get fed up with Mander's super speed and Gatling gun him to death instead. I run into the next room where Palefawn doesn't care at all about his servants being dead. He summons the demon, the game's final boss. He starts by punching across the small area we have to stand in. Being hit will also stun you for a bit. Palefawn will then fly by with machine gun fire and homing missiles. The demon will then spit a fireball that splits into a wave at each travel to both ends of the floor. Palefawn passes by and I unload the Gatling gun on him. It damages his machine and he accidentally shoots the demon, leading to the demon punching him in return. That does 75 damage. Then the pattern repeats with some slight changes. When the demon spits fire, both sides now get two waves. I get Palefawn to shoot the demon again, reducing them to half health. This time the fire the demon spits has different spacing, making it easier to jump into fire while trying to dodge it. This time I keep getting hit and stunned by Palefawn's missiles, missing a couple chances to do damage. But I do eventually get that third hit in, just one left. This time the demon spits three waves of fire and all the damage I've received adds up, leading to Palefawn gunning me down. But next time I do much better and get that last hit in, now I know how better to dodge the attacks. The damage from Palefawn's gun kills the demon, but it makes sure to get a parting blow on him. Dan approaches the fiery wreckage to see a still barely living Palefawn pinned under it.
I suppose a decent thing would be to admit defeat. But I ain't a decent man. If I'm going down, I'm taking you with me. It's funny. All my life, all I wanted was a little respect. And world domination, of course. For people to notice. Well, they'll notice this.
Dan manages to escape the explosion and climb to safety where Kier and the Professor arrive to check on him. Winston doesn't get to be in FMVs. As they leave the ruins, the time machine appears and Dan gets on, Kier coming with him. They land back in Dan's time, in the same room he killed Zarok. Only they are ambushed and killed by Palefawn in Zarok's dragon form. Yeah, getting 100% actually gets you the bad ending. I don't know whose idea that was or why. Well, time to show off the cheat menu and the good non-100% ending. I can give myself infinite health and max ammo, automatically obtain the chalice and end the level. But most important are the novelty head sizes. We have big head, tiny head, wide head and gigantic head, which I'm keeping. I can also have all levels unlocked so I can skip right to the demon, which I kill with my invincibility. This time, without all the chalices, Dan and Kia return to Kia's tomb in the museum. They say their goodbyes to the professor, but not Winston, fuck him, and the two return to their eternal rest in Kia's coffin, together. I quite like this ending. Yeah, Kia is a nothing character with about three lines, she never says a single word after Dan saves her from the Ripper, but I don't dislike her or anything. I like the idea that instead of just being left alone in his crypt or on display, this time Dan gets to rest with someone who actually cares about him. And it means Kia gets a second, or third now I guess, chance at a more dignified end than being mummified alive. It would be over 20 years before we ever got any kind of product set after this game, so I always preferred to see this ending as the true ending to the series and the end of Dan's story. Of course, now it's definitely not the case, and that's fine too. But as for the game itself, MediEvil 2 is not as good as the first game. I don't think it's a bad game, I still like it, but I find it more heavily flawed. The frustrating part about it is the worst aspects were deliberate changes from the first game to make the game worse, like the addition of fall damage and the limited healing fountains. Plus, while there are still good levels, I don't find Victorian London as fun a setting as Gallowmere. But despite that, when we aren't in the bad parts, the base gameplay is still fun, the characters still have their charm, it still has a great soundtrack, and still keeps that medieval atmosphere even in a new setting. It does make me wish we got a true MediEvil 3 instead of the series falling into the Star Fox trap of just becoming remakes and reimaginings of the first game. At the very least, if we're getting that, then we should get some of that attention on this game to iron out those flaws too. Just making Cathedral Spires more bearable would make this game much better. But I haven't played either of those yet, my experience with this series stopped at MediEvil 2. I own Resurrection, but not the PS4 remaster, so from now on I'm in new territory whenever I return to this series.